First of all, I'd like to thank you for selecting my abstract in 19th Wildlife Damage Management Virtual Conference. And my abstract topic is Human Slaughter Conflict in Central Gujarat, a barrier for establishing an ecological corridor. And hello everyone, I'm Shalu Vesaria. I am Senior Project Fellow working in Wildlife and Conservation Biology Research Lab. HNGU University, Patan, Gujarat, and I work with Dr. Nishit Daraya. He is a IUCN sloth bear expert, and our project is sloth bear conservation monitoring and sloth bear research monitoring and conservation, and it goes in two parts. First is conservation outreach activity, and another is evaluation and monitoring of ecological corridors. And on the right side, you can see we have support, a group good support from Forest Department, Government of Gujarat, Bear Trust International, IUCN Bear Specialist Group, and ASA Bear Tag. So starting with my presentation, first of all, I'll introduce to you to the bears of India. So we have four species of bears in India, and three of them are vulnerable. That is Asiatic black bear, sloth bear, sun bear. And the another one is brown bear, it is least concern. And today I'm going to talk about the sloth bear and its distribution in the 18 states. And I'm going to talk about my state, that's Gujarat. And, yeah, so according to IUCN Red List, sloth bears are considered vulnerable. So there are threats to the species like habitat degradation and the conversion of forest land into farming and settlements. So there is another threat, that is sand mining, forest fire, and at times a natural water body or any natural resource can act as a barrier for the movement of the sloth bear. There is another threat, that is poaching. So because of this threats, the species is under vulnerable situation. And going to the historical range of the sloth bear distribution, it had its distribution in the five range countries, that is India, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, and Bangladesh. But in the current distribution, it is recently extirpated from Bhutan and Bangladesh. So now its range is only in three countries, that is India, Sri Lanka, and Nepal. Here you can see the revised range map of sloth bear in the world. So its distribution is very limited to only three countries, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and India. And this is a map showing its range in India. So more than 85% of sloth bear population is held by India alone. Now moving forward, so now when you have a good population of sloth bear, we have attacks, we have conflicts in the forested areas on the forest fringes. So like news like men injured in sloth bear assault, 20 attacks in a year, and then you have sloth bear mauls, Karnataka farmer to death, and then farmer injured. And then at times you get to hear the news like that sloth bear that killed two people is found dead. So it's not just that humans are killed, at times sloth bear also get killed. Similar news you get in my state, that's Gujarat, the news like sloth bear attacks women, one injured in sloth bear attack, then four attempts forest officers get attacked and killed, then the news like the bear which had killed three person is shot dead. This is all what we read in newspaper. Now going to the ground level, what is actually going on ground. So this is the sloth bear landscape in Gujarat. So it is distributed towards the eastern side, and this area is also like tribals also live in this area, in this patch. So in 2016, census was carried out, and sloth bear census was carried out, and it was estimated a total of 342 sloth bear were estimated in 2016. Now our work focuses on the Chota Udaipur, Panchmahal, Vadodara, and Dahod district. It's just the circle, the red circle shows the three districts. And when and then we have conflict. Like you can see on the eastern side, the limit of the range and the conflict. Like it is high conflict area. You can see high conflict zone. And our focus is on the central Gujarat. So now, why we selected this district? So you, there are so many corridors in the southern habitat where we can collect the fragmented forests. But here in our study area, there are like two sanctuaries connecting non-protected forest. Similarly, there are corridors on the northern side, but there are different policy things that can that is to be done. So because of that is what we are going to do in future, but at present I'm just going to discuss the central Gujarat right now. So now these are the Panchmahal, Dahod and Chota Udaipur are the three districts, and the yellow boundary shows a sanctuary area, protected area. So on the right side you have Ratanmahal Slaughter Sanctuary, and on the left side we have Jamugoda Wildlife Sanctuary. Now the dark green color shows the dense forest. So that is where sloth bear is, the density of the sloth bear is high in that area. And you can see the blue water body in the center, that's a Sukhi Dam. Now, in this area, in between the sanctuary, there is high settlement, like settlement where the tribals, locals live. Now, so we conducted, so we know where settlement is, we know where dense forest is, but now we wanted to know the sloth bear presence in this area. So we conducted a survey, signed survey, and we concluded that this is the area where we got signs of the sloth bear. So this is the last 3 month data. So our project, we actually plot our project, started our project in November 2020, and from there we got this data. Now we know where sloth bear are present, and we collected conflict data from the forest department because we want to know the where the sloth bear, to whom sloth bear attack. And we also met victim and non-victims, and to understand the nature of attack and the perception towards wildlife, we had a series of questions, and we investigated in detail what happened to them, how many sloth bears they saw, and how many sloth bears were there, what were they doing in the forest, or what was the actual location, was it around human settlement or in the forest fringe. And after collecting this data, we analyzed and we got something like this. So this is, so you can see the sloth bear attacks are prevalent throughout the year. So we had this data, we have this 10 years of data, and we concluded that the highest attacks are observed in the month of April, May and June. So this is the summer season here, and the season is dry, and water availability is very less in forest, and so because of that sloth bear wander around the forest fringes, or they come to the human settlement in the search of food and water. But the interesting thing here is the fruiting species present in the summer season is high. So the fruiting species is what locals also prefer in this area, and they wander in the forest for the search of fruits, and tribals also visit forest to collect the timbru leaves. And okay, so timbru leaves is basically used for the smoking tobacco, and there is another thing that they go to the forest for, mahua fruit collection. So mahua fruit is mainly used to prepare local wine, and so these are the two things for which locals visit forest, and the chances of getting encountered with sloth bear is high. And other thing that they go in the forest is for collection of the honeycomb and jamun fruit. So now you can see the time period gets overlapped, activity time period of sloth bear and humans. It gets overlapped, and resources are shared here. So the only thing that is not shared is termites and ants. Rest, everything, all the food diet, the food, food components are shared between locals and sloth bears. So this is the reason because of which the animal attacks human when they get a sudden encounter. Now, the number of attacks on the sloth bear, the number of attacks on male is high as compared to females. So the age group of 31 to 50 gets highly attacked. So why so? So the age group of 20 to 30 is usually a migrant worker. They go outside their district to work in the different districts. And the age group of 31 beyond, they get married, they get settled in their hometown, and they continue farming. And they also go in the forest to collect firewood. And in the early morning, they have to go to the farm. There are the crop raidings, because wild boar or nilgai raid their crops. So to protect their crops, they have to go to the farm in the night time. That is where they get encountered with a sloth bear. Now, our target is to reach to the school-going children, to educate them that what is actually going on in the habitat with respect to sloth bear. So we are aware, we are creating awareness, we are promoting, we are giving them education through about the sloth bear, how to protect themselves when they encounter sloth bear. And so the type of injury in sloth bear attack, we got this data from the compensation. So compensation received to the victim from government. So the majority of injury was low, and there were very few deaths. And the compensation received by the low injury victim is usually around $65, and the victim when death is recorded, the compensation received is, I guess, around $2,600. So what is this related to our what I'm actually trying to say is, the number of attacks observed is the attacks in self-defense. They don't want to harm humans. They are doing self-defense here. So in the summer one, when the season is actually dry, they are in the search for mate. They are in search for water and food. And they, and the locals, the tribe will also visit in the forest. So days are longer. So they have got maximum time to collect the fruits and firewood from the forest. So this is a time when they encounter with the sloth bear. And maximum, because of this reason, maximum attacks are recorded in this season. So now this is something interesting that I'm currently working on. So attacks observed during different moon phases. And it is seen that the attacks observed maximum is on waxing crescent, waxing gibbous, waning gibbous, and waning crescent. So I don't know how this is useful to me, like I'm still working on this thing, but this is just a question to the viewers that can you predict the active time period or movement in the human habitat by understanding the attacks observed during different moon phases? So when we interacted with locals, we collected so many we asked them so many questions. At present, they are very much hesitant to talk. So first of all, we have to make them sure, like what we have come from, whatever data we want from them. Have they seen sloth bear? How many sloth bear have they seen? Mother and cub, and do they know the location of the sloth bear? Along with that, we also ask them the two major questions on which our focus is off, is sloth bear a threat to the humans? Does sloth bear needs protection? So majority of answers were unsure. They were like, they don't know what to answer. They were like, okay, we don't know. Like, I don't know what you are asking. So those were the answers that we got. And there was a population who were like, agree to the questions to what we asked. And it is really difficult to get answers from them, because they think that, okay, something might happen if they answer us. So majority of the tribals, they were hesitant to talk. And females, usually they don't answer. They will just like, okay, go and ask somebody else. I don't know. You get to hear this such type of answers from them. And so what we are actually doing right now is what we want is coexistence. So with the number of attacks rising and the slogan movement, and there's this fear of getting attacked by the slogan, the hostility and intolerance of locals may hamper the goal of establishment and conservation of such corridors. So what we want here, what we expect, is local support for conservation of the sloth bear habitat, and that is what we are doing through outreach activity. And we are focusing mainly school going children, and the regular monitoring of this corridor is to keep a vigil on sloth bear movement, and this may help instill some positivity and tolerance of locals towards wildlife. And we are doing sign survey and capacity building of forest staff. We are also making sure that forest staff is capable to look after the habitat and the corridor area. So yeah, so what this is what we are expecting the locals and in between locals and sort of the coexistence. Now the title of our project is Atmavat Sarva Bhuteshu, which means it's a Sanskrit phrase basically, and it means one should feel the happiness and distress of others as his own. So yeah, and here we are also sensitizing locals towards wildlife, and I would like to say that if someone is interested in collaborating, supporting, or assisting with us in our work, they may feel free to contact us. This is my mail ID. This is my Dr. Nishidharaya's mail ID. And with this, I would like to thank Gujarat Forest Department, all the field staff, and my team, Suza Petro, Solstice Zoo Hungary, Marcel Alays, Elsa Bear Tag, Bear Trust International, and IUCN Bear Specialist Group. And with this, I would like to end my presentation, and thank you.